And I'm here with Ileana Goldbestein, who is a pharmacist, chemist, chief of standards for the Vaping Trade Association of New Zealand. Welcome, Ileana. It was great to look at your presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
I'll start off with a question that intrigues a lot of our people on the comments. Why do so many doctors seem so anti-nicotine unless it's given as a medicine?
I think it's because the information that has been passed through them through different associations, it's very misleading. Even the World Health Organization is misleading them. So nicotine per se, as we know, it's actually, depending on how I explained before, toxicology, is not necessarily harmful or is harmful in that way. And I think what happens is that the pharmaceutical industry is trying to demonstrate that only the products that they have available are only products that actually work, because they have very fancy and expensive science to demonstrate that. However, we have seen how the products that they're offering to us are actually not doing their work that, you know, they're claiming it. And one of the things that you will see is that many doctors actually not verify these claims very well, because I always wonder why the World Health Organization and all these American associations never question the lack of efficacy of NRTs. It's been like almost 20 years and it was never questioned how ineffective they are. And suddenly we have this rock star, vaping rock star, and it's working and it's doing wonders. It's saving my mom. And suddenly, oh no, it's not effective, it's not working, it doesn't work for anything. So this is when you start questioning who's actually behind those lies and what are they trying to do. And I'm actually surprised that many doctors that understand very well the scientific method are falling on these lies.
Well, that's it. And just to say that NRT, I'm assuming, just assuming that that means nicotine replacement therapies.
Exactly, yes.
Cool. We do use a lot of acronyms. Now, we hear stories from vapers that since they switch from smoking to vaping, that they really have an improvement in their asthma or their COPD. So why is that so? Like, is there empirical research? Because we get this a lot from people saying it, you know, feedback from vapers particularly, feeling that they're much better. Is there any empirical evidence proving that to be the case?
So asthma is a multifactorial condition. In general, some asthmatics, the reason why they are asthmatic is because they have a very oversensitive airways and they get irritated easily. And irritation inside of the airways make the lungs became red and inflamed. It's causing inflammation. So inflammation is actually multifactorial and complex to understand. But in short, it makes them unable to breathe properly. And the ways in which we can understand the harm that is caused by exposure, then we just have to compare, okay? So smoking is a very particular risk factor that contributes to asthma. It triggers asthma in smokers. So some people actually don't experience that thing because asthma is multifactorial, but some people actually, smoking affects and worsens their asthma. Vaping, on the other hand, because the level of exposure of possible toxicants are way less, and in smoking we have 200 known asthma-inducing compounds. In vaping, we have few that are very specific to specific persons. So it is really hard to say that both are equal and they both cause the same, particularly when vaping has such a significantly lower concentration of potential substances that can induce asthma. But it is also responsible to say that some vapers experience or that their asthma worsens. It's approximately, I would say, between 2 to 10%, but that's very specific sometimes to flavors or particular flavors, or because they are vaping PG, because PG sometimes have this irritating effect. But this is not the reason of why we are not helping that other 98% of asthmatics that have this condition improved by vaping. And the rationale is the same for COPD. So COPD is the difference with COPD and asthma, that COPD is chronic and it develops by the deposition of those little particles, actually solids, that they get in your lining of your lungs. So you don't get to produce these particles when you are actually vaping. I mean, some people will come with gymnastic science because trying to make up things that they don't exist to create ghosts where they are not. And you will see that with the knowledge, with the field of analytical chemistry that I have, that you will not find combustion-related particles in vaping unless you're vaping with a wattage over 200 watts or something like that, and you're toasting your liquid, okay? And some people trying to say, yes, we found, you know? But if you compare the levels of particles that you release from a vaping device or from a cigarette, it's like you are trying to complete, it's like if I'm trying to compare the amount of salt that you find in an ocean, in the case of smoking, or the amount of uranium-238 that I find in Lake Taupo here in New Zealand.
Yeah, that's an excellent point. And those, now that leads straight into my next question, which is really with media and governments, you know, they continue to follow research, which you alluded to before, is this research which doesn't really stand up to scrutiny, particularly from that ignores independent peer-reviewed scientific studies. There's some, I think, out of the US from Stan Glantz and others. How do we get a more balanced and rational scientific evidence-based element into the debate with regulators? What are the challenges we face?
Well, the challenges are it is money behind. There is billions and billions of dollars of people paying for displaying bad science and put it in a high stage. So this is problem one. We can't fight that. You know, we are not rich. We are not rich as Bloomberg. But the important element is that we are able to understand and to see the devices. So it's very easy. If you take a paper and you notice that paper has something off, you just need to take the name of the author, Google it, or go Google Academic, and then you will find out whether that person is a true skeptic in the sense, because science is a skeptical, you know, a true scientist is someone that is a skeptical. But you can be a healthy skeptic or you can be a toxic skeptic, okay? Like Glantz. Actually, Glantz is not even a toxic skeptic, he's a liar, okay? But Glantz, Chapman, or scientists that are sponsored by asthma foundations around the world, except the UK, or American public health sectors or organizations that receive funding from tobacco taxation or pharma bonuses or colonial pseudo philanthropism, like the American Heart Association, the American Medical Association and such. So you have to kind of like, oh, if it's coming from them, I need to be really careful because I know this is loaded with a lot of partialized biased information. Okay, so this is first. And yeah, this is what I can say, like with COVID-19, we've seen how many scientists are denying many epidemiological studies done by different scientists that are not even related to this field. And they have so much information, which is like I calculated, it's 455 different reports regarding this issue around. There is 200 about epidemiological studies. There is 12 very solid studies. And I believe if we demand a healthy skepticism from real and unbiased scientists, we would find a way to change this narrative.
And so going from the negative to the positive, are there any resources online where, you know, people just out there in the community can find this peer-reviewed scientific research that is accessible for them, you know, for use as people within the community, as advocates?
I mean, believe it or not, Twitter is a great tool. And there is a guy on Twitter called Phil. I don't know exactly his name. And he's just like you guys, like a vapor. And he's following each of those papers. And sometimes the problem with the COVID, the problem with science is that a lot of that knowledge is not available. Okay. But COVID-19 has enabled access for all those related papers. And these papers wouldn't be normally available to the general public if it's not because we are in the middle of a pandemic. But unfortunately, the scientific world is still very elitist, and this knowledge is not shared and communicated effectively with the wider public. Mm. And this is very harmful because this generates hidden pockets of power that are sustained with inaccessible knowledge. However, there is many ways in which you can access this information and get properly informed. As I mentioned, Twitter, sometimes you can email the people that are writing a paper and they can give it to you kindly. And just for instance, the ATRA website, the Australian Tobacco Harm Reduction Association, they have a very clean website that is actually very user-friendly, and you can access some information that they keep updating properly. And actually, there are ways around, but I agree with it's not easy. Oh, it's not easy. So, and it's even worse if you get this information from media, because media loves sensationalism and biases and, you know, to misinform the community.
It can be tough, that's for sure. Now, there's a figure that's bandied around in terms of vaping being at least 95% safer or less harmful than smoking. Do you agree with that? Why is that?
So the way that was designed, and a lot of people still saying, oh, that's very weak. Actually, it's not weak evidence. They took 55 different biomarkers that you find in cigarettes, and that are not just related to combustion. They're also biomarkers that are known for attributed to DNA damage, and biomarkers that you can take from a person and analyze. Mm. When you compare the biomarkers that you get from vaping exposure or tobacco exposure, and with information we already have from smoking, which is more than 100 years and 50s in science, is starting to be more careful about studying the smoking exposure. It's very easy as scientists to model the prospective harm of vaping. And that's why Public Health England and many other organizations in the world, even New Zealand, our Ministry of Health is endorsing that statement. They say it, yes, vaping is at least 95% safer than smoking. And actually that statement was done a little bit ago. Technology has changed so much that I'm sure we are like in the 3%, 2%, and we are very close to go 1%. And this is one of the good things about vaping. You can improve that. Innovation can improve and can make these products even safer and safer with the time.
Yeah. And what about other products like snus, which is the small pouches of pasteurized tobacco, and also heating of tobacco?
Yeah, so the harm for heated not tobacco is...
So what about...
So I think 10% for heat not burn, and using similar ways of analyzing that, which is biomarkers. For snus, we have approximately an 8% that can change sometimes. It depends on how the tobacco leaves are processed. And for nicotine pouches, the harm is actually even below vaping. You'll be surprised. And some countries are putting blanket bans on nicotine pouches. And the attributed harm from nicotine pouches is actually the same that you get from NRTs, which is nicotine replacement therapies. So you see how uncomfortable this can be for the pharmaceutical lobby.
And just and on that last point, and this is just to wind up, what are the differences between NRT and vaping? You know, what are the principal differences? How are they different?
They are not necessarily that different. Actually, you are replacing nicotine. NRT is a pharmaceutical term that I believe it should stay that way, because they have a place and they play an important role for some people. I would call just vape as it is. I don't want vaping to be medicalized. And I will say that they do pretty much the same in the sense of giving to the user that a delivery of nicotine that the user wants. Okay. And it's either by oral, by your skin, and sometimes it can be even inhaled. So there's nicotine sprays. Nasal sprays that can be even inhaled and can go even up to your lungs, even though most of it will be absorbed in your upper respiratory tract. But in theory, they're not very different. The key factor that makes vaping different is the heating element. Okay, and that's what makes vaping not likely to be a pharmaceutical form unless big pharma stars somehow funding projects into developing their own vape, you know, and we just have to be careful because,
excellent. Well, that's explained it very well, Ileana, and thank you for your time. Thank you for the Q&A session. That's all we've got time for this segment. And now we'll move on to the next.